Here's a quick tutorial on hypothesis testing. We're going to learn two different ways to do hypothesis testing in this class. We're going to learn the classical method and the p-value method. So I'll do examples of both here. I'm not going to talk you through all the subtleties of what's going on. I'll kind of just illustrate an example to give you an idea to reinforce some of the topics that we'll learn in class. We're going to do lots of different hypothesis testing. We're going to first do z-testing, which is quantitative data when sigma is known. And then later we'll see the same idea in different settings. Okay, so the idea when you're doing hypothesis testing, maybe the first thing you want to do is go through, read the problem, and pull out all the pertinent information. So in this case, it says, suppose we know that the average baseball player hits 25 home runs with a standard deviation of 10. Okay, we're talking about all baseball players here. We're talking about population values. And the population average is 25, and the population standard deviation is 10. For population standard deviation, we've been using the symbol sigma, and we will continue to do so. For the population average, we've been using the symbol mu. However, we want to use the symbol mu for something else in this problem. So we're going to create a new symbol, mu naught, mu with a little zero next to it. And that's what we'll use for our population values. Then we have a sample of 50 players that we're talking about here. As we've been doing, we'll use the letter n to represent the number of observations in our sample. And for those 50 players, on average, 29 home runs were hit. The sample average is 29. As we've been doing, we'll use X bar to represent that. And then what we want to do is test the claim that HGH increases home runs, and we want to have 95% confidence. You may recall that alpha is 1 minus our level of confidence. Alpha will be something that's important in these problems. So I'm going to go ahead and write out that alpha is equal to 0.05 in this case. And then one more symbol, I don't know that you need to write this out every time, but it might be helpful, is mu. I said we were saving mu for something different. What mu is going to represent in this problem is a population average but it's not the same as this one. So this was the population average of all baseball players. This is the population average of all players if they're on HGH. So of all players on HGH. The idea there is this is the thing that we want to compare to the 25. Yeah, we know that our sample value is greater than 25, but the question is the population value greater than 25? A sample could be greater than 25. I mean, in this case, it's 29 just out of dumb luck. Could just be better hitters out of these 50 players. But if the population average of all players on HGH is higher than the population average of all players, then we know that HGH is increasing home runs. All right, so what you do on these problems is you're always going to first state your null and alternative hypothesis. For the null hypothesis, we'll use H0, or H0 is the way you say it, and your alternative hypothesis down here is H1. Your alternative hypothesis is what your claim is. So sometimes it's easier to start with your alternative hypothesis. In this case, we claim that HGH increases home runs. So to write that in terms of formulas, we're saying that this thing, the population average of all players on HGH, is greater than the population average of all players. That mu is greater than mu naught. In other words, mu is greater than 25. If I said test the claim that HGH decreases home runs, then this would be mu is less than 25. But whether it's greater than or less than, it's a one-tailed example. If it's greater than, it's a right-tailed. Maybe I'll even write that here. If it were less than, if I said test the claim that HGH decreases home runs, it would be left-tailed. And down here, we'll see something completely different where it's two-tailed. Your null hypothesis. So your null hypothesis is kind of saying that, I mean, in a way, it's that your claim is wrong, but it's not quite that. Because if it were just that your claim is wrong, we'd put that mu is less than or equal to 25. But that's not what we want. We want that mu is equal to 25. What you'll see is your null hypothesis will always have equality here. What your null hypothesis is saying is HGH doesn't matter one way or another. That mu equals 25. That the population average of all players on HGH is just the same as the population average of all players. It makes no difference if you take an HGH. All right. Once you've stated your null and alternative hypothesis, in order to make these similar to our other problems, we're going to state the shape, the center, and the spread of our distribution. And the nice thing is these will be pretty similar to what we've seen in prior problems. For the shape of our distribution, just like in every single example we've had in this class, it'll be approximately normal. But you always want to say why it's approximately normal. In this case, it's approximately normal because n is greater than or equal to 30. Our cutoff for using the central limit theorem in our book is that n is greater than or equal to 30. We have a value of n of 50. Cool, it's approximately normal. When I draw my picture, I'm going to draw it approximately normal. Go ahead and draw my picture over here. Why not? I'm going to draw my distribution. It's a pretty good one. And I'm going to try to make it approximately normal. Center. Center of our distribution is mu naught, which is equal to 25. The idea there is really our center is mu, but we don't know mu. So what we're going to do is we're going to assume that our null hypothesis is correct. We're going to assume that mu is equal to 25. We're going to assume that this thing is 25, and then we're going to figure out how unlikely would it be to get this kind of a sample if mu really were 25. And then our spread is something we've seen before. Spread of a sampling distribution, it's sigma divided by the square root of n. Sigma in this case is 10. N in this case is 50. If you do 10 over root 50, you get 1.4 or something. 10 divided by square root of 50. You get 1.41, we'll call it. Something like that. Shape, center, spread. All right, now we're going to go over here and draw our picture. Picture is going to be a little different. One thing that'll be different about it is we're going to have both x values and z values. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to draw my x values on this line, and then below it, I'm going to put my z values. So put one of them in parentheses if you want. You could say x equals and z equals, or you could write it just like this, and we'll see what it means. And then what we want to do is create what's called a critical region. I like to call it a rejection region, but your book uses the word critical region. And so the way you do that is you look up at alpha, and alpha equals 0.05. Alpha is always the total area of our rejection region, or regions of our rejection. So in this case, there's just one region. But what we'll see in the next example is there could be more than one region, and we'll talk through that. And alpha is always the total area of it. And in this case, since we're doing a right-tailed test, we want our rejection region to be on the right. In other words, I want to draw something over here. Maybe I'll shade in this area. And I want that shaded in area on the right side to be 5%. I want this value right here to be 0.05. Okay, so I guess we should figure out what that value is. Your calculator has a function that'll figure out what that value is. You can figure out the x value or the z value for that. Really what we'll use is the z value. That'll be what's most important, although you can figure them both out on your calculator. And the way you figure them out is under this distribution menu. If you hit second variables, and then if you go to inverse norm. What inverse norm does as a function is it takes in the area below the point in question. So if I'm trying to find this point right here, I have to give it the area below that point, which in this case is 0.95. And then since I want a z value, I'm going to put 0 and 1 in for my center and my spread, and I'm going to get 1.645 down here. You could also figure out this value if you wanted to, although you don't have to figure out this value here. So there we go. The critical value, the value on the edge of our critical region or our rejection region, is 1.645 in this case. All right, so this picture will work. We only need one more thing. We just need to know what our test statistic is. And what our test statistic is it's kind of saying, where does this 29 fall in this picture right here? Where is 29? We can figure out where 29 is in our picture using our calculators. And so if you hit stat and then go over to tests and then do a z-test, the first one, it'll ask you for all the information. It'll first ask you if you have data or statistics. In this case, we don't have the amount of home runs hit by player. We just have statistics about those. And it asks you for a bunch of stuff that we have. Mu naught, it's nice that it uses the same symbol we use, is 25. Sigma, again, it uses the same symbol we use, is 10. Be careful, don't put in 1.41. It doesn't want to know sigma sub x bar. It wants to know sigma, which is 10. X bar, figured out that was 29. N, we figured out that was 50. Or it was given that that was 50. And now here, what it's asking you for is your alternative hypothesis. It's saying, is mu not equal to mu naught? Is mu greater than mu naught? Or is mu less than mu naught? So not equal to, less than, greater than. In our case, it's this one. It's that mu is greater than mu naught, because mu naught is the 25. So our alternative hypothesis is this third one here. So you highlight that, and then you hit calculate. And what it'll do is give you some information. The most important piece of information in here for classical hypothesis testing is this z value here. And what that z value does is it tells you where this 29 home runs is on our picture. In other words, 29 home runs is way the hell out here at a z-score of 2.83. So what that's saying is, so maybe I'll go ahead and draw my conclusion. What's important to figure out is whether the z-score is in the rejection region or not in the rejection region. But because 2.83 is greater than 1.645, it's in the rejection region here. So then our conclusion will be because our test statistic of 2.83 is in the rejection region, there is sufficient evidence to reject the null hypothesis and conclude that HGH, and conclude basically that our claim is correct, that HGH increases home runs. This might seem like a lot to remember, but it'll turn out there's really only two conclusions we can draw. If the test statistic is in the rejection region, we reject the null hypothesis and therefore conclude that the alternative hypothesis is right. And if the test statistic is not in the rejection region, we just say there's not enough evidence to reject the null hypothesis, and that's it. We don't conclude that HGH doesn't increase home runs. We just say there wasn't enough evidence to conclude that it did increase home runs. But in this case, the test statistic was in the rejection region, as this picture illustrates. So we conclude that there is sufficient evidence to conclude with 95% confidence that HGH increases home runs. Whew. I guess that's the end. I'm going to stop this video and make a new one to show the p-value hypothesis testing, just because I don't want this to get too long. So I'll make another video showing you how to do this p-value. In this case, we'll have a two-tailed example, so it'll show a slightly different picture and illustrate a few more of these ideas.